Hello, everybody. So this is kind of a different setup. This is what you'll see if we have our one-on-one coaching sessions together. This is the other side of the filming session. You can see my camera behind me and these light boxes, but this is my working station. I'm in front of my computer right now. I want to do a different setup in terms of talking about the stock market. And today's discussion will be why the stock market went up. And again, I'm not a genius, and I wouldn't say I'm the best stock market investor ever. And so everything I say will be just take it as a grain of salt, entertainment purposes only. I have to CMA. Yeah, so please don't sue me, bro. Today, we will talk about, did we reach a bottom? First of all, I'll cover why the stock market went up, and then I'll talk about my strategy. I'll talk about my biggest portfolio winners and losers in terms of my growth portfolio and my dividend portfolio. And I'll talk about why I don't day trade, because I get this question also a lot. In addition, I will talk about how do I keep buying all these different stocks, because I also get this question a lot. And without further ado, let's get started. And so first of all, I want to talk about why the market went up. So a lot of people, they probably were really upset about how the market went down. Let me just do a quick Google. Why the market went up. So let me share my screen. Okay, so basically what I did over here was just share why the market went up, all the angry people who are like, everything's awful. So why is the stock market booming? Why the stock market is healthy as Americans die? So a lot of these are just people's confusion, why the stock market went up. And without going through all these articles, of course, you can Google and read these articles, but I'm just going to give you my thoughts why the stock market went up. So in my opinion, there are two main reasons, or actually three main reasons, why the stock market went up. First of all, I want to say that reality, sometimes when reality is less bad, if reality is less bad than the investor's expectations, it is actually very likely that the stock market is going to go up, because the stock price already takes into account of its predictions and of its expectations. And so if reality is better than the expectations, then it is possible that the stock market would go up. And also in addition to that is that the current stock price, a lot of it is already accounted for. And so if we look at the S&P 500, if we look at it like 6 months, you can see there is a huge drop over here, like a 30% drop over here. So it is very likely that the worst has already been accounted for, and you can see it is going back up. And I wouldn't say that this is like definitely just a real bull run. Of course, I don't know. I'm not like a magician and I'm not a fortune teller. If I know, I would be much richer than now. But I just want to say that either way, it is likely, or it is possible, that this is an actual bull run. We can't know for sure, but that is a possibility. And that's why I really urge everyone to do dollar cost averaging, because timing the market is just so difficult. That's why so many people got caught off guard, and so many people are so angry right now thinking, why the frick is the stock market going up? Because they were expecting the stock market to go down, and they were probably buying a lot of like SPY puts, hoping that the market would go down, even though obviously it did not go down. And another perspective is that a lot of seasoned investors, they have actually been predicting this bear run for quite a long time already, this bear market for quite a long time, because as you know, we've already been in a bull run for 10, 11 years, and it's about time for us to hit a bear run. So that's why a lot of seasoned investors, they actually have a lot of cash sit on the side so that they can take advantage of any sort of market dip, kind of like what we experienced around February 21st. And then it just kept going down, down, down. And then there is a rebound towards the end of March, as you can see over here. And so let's say if you were doing dollar cost averaging throughout the way, you will be able to take advantage of all these dips along the way, instead of just waiting for the like giant dip, instead of timing the market and going like, okay, I will for sure know on March 21st or March 23rd, that is the lowest point. There's really no way for anyone to know that for sure. And so instead of doing that, for us DCA people, we just keep dollar cost averaging our way down, and we can take advantage of every dip that happens. And of course, there's also the part that when it goes up, you also take advantage of the fact that it is quite expensive, but then you also take advantage of the fact that Sometimes the market goes down, and so you'll be able to buy the dip without timing the market. So that is also a little explanation of what DCA is. And so that is my observation of why the market went up. And of course, again, just to CMA, I want to make sure that you don't take this as like investing advice. Always invest with your own due diligence, doing your own research and due diligence. And what I'm saying right here is just for entertainment purposes only. Please don't sue me, bro. And so now that we've talked about why the market went up, let's look into my personal portfolio and see my biggest winners and losers from my three biggest portfolios. So my Robinhood portfolio and my Fidelity portfolio, these are my growth portfolio, and also my M1 finance portfolio. And since this is a dividend investing channel, I'm going to be showing you guys my dividend investing portfolio first. And so this is my M1 Finance portfolio. Currently, I'm at $19,183.53. My net cash flow is $3,174.95. So this is the money that I put into this portfolio. My market loss is $2,263.01. And I have $72.98 in dividends. And you can see this is already a lot better than before. Before I was losing like 20-something%. Right now it's only 10% because you can see this rebound. The market is going up again. And let's go to my holdings to see all my different holdings. And so if we arranged by unrealized gain and loss, you can see my biggest losers. So currently I have 46 positions. My cost basis is $20,336.01. Right now the value is $19,183.53. And I have the unrealized loss of $1,152.48, down by 5.67%. And over here you can see that I have the unrealized gain or unrealized loss for NRZ. It's down by 27.22%. And this is pretty reasonable, pretty predictable, I want to say, because if you click into NRZ, you can see this is a REIT, and REITs get hit a lot, especially because residential real estate around the US, and you probably know that with the RONI situation that is going on, REITs got hit a lot. So it is not a surprise that all my REITs are doing pretty poorly. This is not the only REIT that I have. I also have other REITs. And let's go back to here. Other than this, also AT&T is down by 17.58%, down by $224.26. And the reason why it is so high on the loss list is because I have relatively a lot of AT&T compared to everything else. So that's why even though it is only 17.58%, I did lose like around $200. And also SPG, which is also very, very predictable, because with this RONI situation, the malls are closed. So it is very, very predictable that SPG would be doing quite poorly, and also Store Capital, again, doing quite poorly. That's quite predictable. And the fifth one is Realty Income, which also went down by 15.61%. And I have a relatively large amount of Realty Income compared to the rest of the things that I have. So also pretty predictable that this is so on top, like high up on the list. With Tapestry, honestly, this is the kind of stock that I will keep buying, not with this portfolio, but with my Fidelity portfolio, which you will see in a second. And so let's look at the biggest gains. So biggest gains, you can see LQD. I have quite a lot of LQD, and it's up by 11%. Microsoft, I'm up by 12.63%. Amazon, I'm up by 13.98%, which is, again, very predictable, because now that we can't really go out and wander and buy things as easily. For Amazon, of course, they have a lot of extra orders, and Amazon Fresh, Whole Foods deliveries, even though I never got mine to work, I'm sure some other people got theirs to work. And also for Starbucks, Starbucks also went up by 43.91%, which I'm actually really surprised. It looks like maybe it could be my cost basis is relatively low. I'm not sure why it's 43.91%. I don't think Starbucks went up that much. Oh, it did? Oh, interesting. So it looks like Starbucks has this like crazy, crazy upward run that I wasn't paying attention of. But yeah, it looks like it's a pretty crazy run, and I've been doing DCA all my way, so I didn't even pay attention to each price. And the beauty of DCA is that you don't have to so carefully track the stock market every single day, and you can actually devote more time to your hobbies. Going back to Welltower, also went up by 5.02%, and also, of course, everyone's favorite Tesla is also up by 1.96%, and this is also another stock that I bought with my other growth portfolio with my Fidelity. So now that I've mentioned my Fidelity account, let's take a look at my Fidelity investments. So this is my Fidelity. Currently, you can see that this account is overall green. There are only two reds over here for the day, and you can see that's ELF and Visa. And the Fidelity portfolio, I really made it because Robinhood was giving me a lot of hiccups, and there were a lot of failures on their end, a lot of bugs that I lost a lot of buying opportunity and money on. So that's why I switched to Fidelity, and my stocks are still not transferred over. After I transfer the stocks over, it wouldn't be 28K or almost 29K. It would be, I think I have 40K in my Robinhood portfolio. We're going to take a look of that together next. And so this is still like kind of a baby portfolio. I am still trying to build this up. You can see right here, I have Boeing, Alibaba, CCL, Disney, ELF, Facebook, Revolve, Starbucks, Tapestry, Tesla, Uber, and Visa. And all of these stocks I already own in my Robinhood portfolio. It's just that I start buying, like continuing my purchases on this portfolio. One thing that I really like about Fidelity is how reliable it is and how fast it is. Even though with the current market volatility, it is increasingly difficult for me to get a hold of their real staff. So every time I call them, my call just gets dropped. They just hang up on me. So not the best feeling, I must say. And so if I look at the total gains and loss, which is what I'm really, really focused on, since I'm not a day trader, I don't really care that much about how much I make in a daily, since I'm not planning to sell. Over here, you can see that I only have one loser so far. And the reason why I only have one loser is because I've been buying the dip. I've been kind of trying to time the market with this portfolio. I kind of saw that a lot of stocks were at its 52-week low. And you know that when all these dots are closer to the left-hand side, and that means they're at its 52-week low. And so that's where when I see that, I just keep buying more. So for example, if I just look at this chart right now, if I really wanted to buy something like anything, if I just have so much money that I just want to pour it into the stock market, I would probably buy Revolve because it's closer to the 52-week low, even though, of course, it's like only one of the many indicators that I look at while I buy. And if you subscribe to my channel, you will be able to see a lot of the philosophy and also like my way of doing things, the reason why I make certain decisions. But over here, you can see that these are the stocks that I've decided to buy. I've done my research. I use my stock analysis template to do research, which you can find in the info box. I'm also trying to really refine that and make it a lot more automatic. So if you keep subscribing to my channel, you will receive updates about that. But over here, you can see I have my total gains and loss, and I can search by percentage. So you can see by far the biggest gain I have is Boeing. It is up by 58.17%. And currently I only have two shares of this because I don't really agree with management. And I also have a lot of Boeing in my other portfolio already. So that's why I don't have that much of Boeing, but you can see it bounced back pretty great. Also for Tapestry, I mentioned that in my previous portfolio, my M1 Finance portfolio that I'll be buying in this portfolio. And you can see that it's almost at its 50% gain. And even though my portfolio is not that big, you can see that it's still a couple hundred dollars, you know, it's still money. And you can see Tesla also had a pretty good rebound. It is up by 44.77%. So that is also pretty good. And then after you look at these three gains, you might be curious, what is my biggest loser? My only loser right now is CCL. CCL, I'm down by 18.56%. And CCL, of course, with the whole Roni situation, people getting sick on cruises, and cruise ships have like a whole ship of people getting sick. It's normal that the business is going to be impacted pretty severely. And if we don't have like a cure for this Roni situation, it is very likely that I wouldn't say they would go bankrupt because they do have a pretty strong balance sheet, but it is likely that this won't recover as fast. And I can't tell you exactly when it's going to recover. Can't tell you that. Just can't tell you that. So that is my only loser out of all. And I also have Disney, which also got really heavily impacted by the Roni situation. All the parks are closed right now. And so it is reasonable that it is not at a very high price right now, even though there is Disney Plus, but that is only one small part of its whole like revenue stream. And over here, Alibaba up by 11.1%, which Alibaba is like always one of my favorite stocks. And of course, in the future, I can do a more in-depth video about Alibaba. But there's a lot of reasons why I like Alibaba. I just want to leave it at that. And also, I feel like there are a lot of similarities between Alibaba and Amazon. I can do a comparison video in the future. Obviously, they're not like exactly the same. One is a Chinese company, one is an American company. But I do see a lot of similarities, and I do see a lot of areas that we can compare between the two. And so this is my Fidelity portfolio, and you probably know that this is a replacement of my Robinhood portfolio. So next I'm going to show you my Robinhood portfolio, which is also another of my growth portfolio. So this is my Robinhood portfolio. Currently I'm at $45,814.89. And by the day you can see I'm in the green, even though today is, I have all these free stocks. Nice. Even though today the market's not open, it's a lovely Sunday. So let me just claim some of these free stock. I don't care. All right. Do I have to click it? Oh, nice. I have ADT, the security company. And then I can also claim it for Alyssa. So thank you, Alyssa, for using my link. Let me tap on this. So $45.40. I feel like Robinhood's pretty stingy with its free stocks. It's always quite low level, or not low level, but low value. So yeah, there's only one time when I actually got a super great stock. Let me just refresh this page just so the notifications go away. Yeah, so this is what's up. You can see I have the cash of $58.54, and I don't want to touch it right now because I want to make sure this actually gets transferred over to my Fidelity. I've been waiting for weeks before I made the rookie mistake of having cryptocurrency within this portfolio. So that's why it's been taking a long time. And so by the week, you can see that I am up by $5,027.39, up by 12.32%, and it's a pretty smooth upward bull run. I don't know if it's a bull trap or a bull run, but as a long-term investor, I really don't care because I look at the long run and I know that if we look at S&P 500 and then like, let's say Max, you can see that it's always been going up, up and up. And even at this like kind of low point, the lowest point right here, it is just comparable to around 2017 or maybe, 2017 time. So you can see there really isn't that big of a difference. It's just like time machine, you go back in time. But overall, even though there are all these dips that come about, we always end up keep going up. So I am not too worried. And over here, 1 month chart, you can see that I am down by only 4.11%, which is actually really good. You can see the lowest point is around here, around March 18th, and it just kept on going up with like low dips around. In the 3 month chart, same thing. You can see that I have a big dip over here. There's a comment that called me a liar and have like that long nose thingy and trying to shame me, but I'm like, no man, I don't know what world you live in, but the big dip did not happen around February. It happened around March. As you can see from this chart, let's go to the 6 month. As you can see from this chart, in February, everything was fine. And so over here, back to this chart, you can see that on February like 18th, there's this big drop. And this big drop is really from me withdrawing my money out. As you can see over here, the big drop did not happen until here. Like you compare the two charts. Anyway, I just want to point that out. I'm not a liar. This just kind of, it's a coincidence that this is around the same time as my stock transfer from this portfolio to my M1 Finance portfolio. It's definitely a coincidence, but I mean, what can I do? It's just a coincidence. And by transferring my stocks, I don't really buy or sell anything in my portfolio. So I don't really take advantage of any dips or any bear market. And so in the 1 year chart, you can also see there's this sharp decline, which definitely is not natural from the stock market. It's definitely just from me transferring stocks. And over here, like this is more normal, this kind of dip, because you see there's like ups and downs. If it's just like a straight down free fall, it's definitely just from the transfer. So don't worry about that. And over here, you can also see from the 1 year chart, it's too straight to be real. And for my biggest winners and losers, we can look at total return. And can I order it? I don't know. I haven't really used my Robinhood portfolio for a while, especially the desktop version, because I don't really like it no more. Yeah, I'm not entirely sure if you can really order everything, but looking at the returns, you can see that some of my winners, just as at a glance, you can see that Baba have some gains, Microsoft have some gains, and these are just all my total gains. This is immaterial. I also have Intel, Tesla, this is Slack, Work, and then I also have 3M, a little bit of gains, ADT, Facebook. Wait, this is not Facebook. This is Facebook, which is still at a loss because Facebook got hit hard. But of course, I also have my other Facebook stock and my Fidelity portfolio. So overall, it's not going to look as bad, as deep in the red. And of course, CCL got hit big. over here, and you can see some of the free stocks I just got, which I have to wait a couple of days before I can sell them. So that is with my growth portfolio. And overall, I just want to say my overall sentiment is that I'm not too worried. I know the market is just volatile to begin with. I knew that coming in. So seeing all this happening, I'm actually really not that worried. And I also want to talk about my strategy. And my strategy is just dollar cost averaging all the way and taking advantage of any big dips that you see. So you can probably see that my M1 Finance portfolio is where I do all the dollar cost averaging, since I have my automatic investments. I have, like, in my activity, you can see that I buy pretty regularly. I deposit like every single week, every single Monday. So that is how I do dollar cost averaging automatically without a worry. And if you want to do the same, of course, I have a link in the info box where you can see that. And also for just taking advantage of the dip, I like to use platforms like Fidelity, or before it was Robinhood, but now it's Fidelity. Platforms where I can pinpoint exactly what price I want to buy it at and in real time, because for M1 Finance it's more passive and I don't necessarily have a say in terms of what price I want to buy it at. I can only determine which allocation. Like, I can say I want 20% of my money going to Apple and 80% going to Amazon, whereas for Fidelity, I don't really focus on the allocation first. I really focus on what price I want to buy it at. So just for, as an example, let's say I want to buy Boeing, I click on the buy, and this is where I can say how much I want to buy it. And I can set like market order, which I will buy at this price, or I can set limit order. So I can actually buy according to what price I want to buy it at. And so far, Fidelity has been pretty good at fulfilling my orders way better than Robinhood, which I really, really enjoy using. That's why I enjoy using Fidelity a lot more. And I also feel like Fidelity is like the more grown up version of Robinhood, which, you know, it's nice to feel more adult. And that is my strategy. It's nothing fancy. And I am pretty, I want to say, a pretty boring investor. And I feel like if you do investing correctly, it should be pretty boring. You shouldn't have a lot of thrills and ups and downs. If that's the case, and you're not really investing, you're really trading. And if you have followed me for a while, you know I'm very, very against day trading. I'm very, very against people who like try to time the market, because I just don't think that is a very sustainable strategy. So I just keep buying the same stock after I've done my research. I don't do like extensive research every single day. I just do it for once, one big, like long research for each of these companies. And then I treat them as companies, not just ticker symbols. So I really look at the business. I really look at the competition. I really look at their competitive advantage and disadvantage. And then I just keep buying. I can even buy them blindfolded. Like, as long as I can see the price is relatively low and lower than my expectations, then I'll buy more. And of course, that is under the assumption that I have money to buy. And so next, I will talk about why I don't day trade, which I kind of already covered in the past. So the reason why I don't day trade is because I feel like the gains and losses, they tend to cancel out each other. So sometimes when you follow day traders, you might see, oh, they made like a couple thousand. I just want to make sure it's recording. You might say that they're making a couple thousand just from like one single day. But then what you don't see is the losses that they have, that they don't show, that they don't share on social media, because you probably know that social media is a very magical place where people only share the good stuff and not the bad stuff. So that's why you always feel kind of like uneasy looking at other people's lives, because you feel like, oh, compared to them, my life is not as glamorous. I just want to say this is the nature of social media. Not a lot of people like to show off their dirty laundry. So that's why you only see the good stuff. And especially for day trading, if there are day traders who like sell courses on day trading, obviously they're only going to show the green and not the red. And if they only show the ups, of course you think, oh, it's so lucrative, they can make so much money, but I don't buy it. I don't think there's a real science behind day trading. And I feel like a lot of the times you only make significant amounts of money if you get into loopholes, which really changes a lot. So a loophole can't last forever. And that is just not my preferred way of investing. And also, in addition to that, is that I personally don't like spending hours and hours every single day on day trading. I know that for day trading, you really have to do it real time. You have to stare at the computer screen. And because of my job and because of where I live, which is the Pacific Standard Time, I don't have the flexibility to wake up at 6 and look at the stock market. It's just not my way of doing things. I'd rather just get my beauty sleep and live my life without worrying about the little ups and downs of the stock market. So it's also because of my lifestyle, my job, and also my personality. And after we covered why I don't day trade, I also want to talk about how do I keep buying into the stock market, which is a lot of people's concern or a lot of people's question. And I also posted a video before talking about my net worth and, you know, all those personal stuff that I am not totally comfortable covering that yet. Maybe in the future, just right now, no. But I just want to say part of why I'm able to keep buying into the stock market is not because my job pays me super well. And I just want to put it out there that accounting is not a super lucrative career. And if you want to get rich quick, definitely don't do accounting. Accounting is a very stable, I want to say highly respected career. It is a good long-term career and you can definitely work your way up with accounting. You can start as a staff accountant and you can become a senior and then a manager, a senior manager, director, and maybe, is there a senior director? Probably not, but yeah, CFO, controller, you name it, CAO, all that good stuff. So you can have a lot of possibility with accounting, which is why I like this space, but at the same time, it is not a super lucrative space and it does not get you rich quick. So if that is your goal, please don't go into accounting and don't say, I forced you to go into accounting because I definitely did not suggest that. If you really want to get rich quick, there are a couple ways. Of course, you can gamble and you can also do day trading, which also can get you broke real fast. You can try starting your own business. You can also try selling courses, which is also very lucrative, which I can cover in a separate video if you guys are interested. Obviously, you can also be a software engineer, which is honestly, if I could go back in time, I would be a software engineer. I wouldn't do accounting. I just want to be real with you. I don't believe in going against the flow. So some people might say, you don't want to get into software engineering just because it pays well. And in my head, I'm just like, why not? Like, obviously that wouldn't be my only reason going to software engineering. I also feel like it's a very highly respected profession and I really respect people who can think with logic. I really, really admire that. And so I feel like when I surround myself in that environment, I will get less headaches dealing with people who are just not logical at all. But on top of that, a lot of my friends are software engineers. I don't know why, or I think I kind of know why because I do work for a tech company. So naturally, probability speaking, I do meet more software engineers than other teams and other professions. And I really enjoy having software engineer friends. I feel like I can really get along with them and they get me, I get them. And it's just a good dynamic. So if I could go back in time, I'll definitely do software engineering. But let's say, assuming now you're already a couple years into your career or like 30, 50 years into your career and you don't want to change, then a good way to increase your earning potential is to take on other income sources. And so here, I'm just going to share my screen with you. I have put together a guide, a 10-page guide. I'm just going to go real quick. So this is the 10-page guide that you can download for free in the info box. And this is the main reason why I'm able to keep investing and building up my net worth without really switching jobs or switching career. And it's because I have multiple income streams coming in. And a lot of these have a compounding effect. So you probably know with investing, there's a compounding effect, but also when you build your own business, there's also the compounding effect. So for example, if I just started my YouTube channel today, of course, my reputation, my brand name wouldn't be the same as someone who has like a 6-year-old YouTube channel. And that is just the nature of the game. And with having a YouTube channel, for example, I say that because this is YouTube. I just want to let you know that there are a lot more ways to make money with YouTube, not just ad revenue. A lot of people, they are very trapped into the mindset thinking that YouTube means YouTube ad revenue means you have to have at least 1,000 subscribers and 40,000 watch time in order to monetize your channel, which is not true. You can monetize it with a lot of ways. And I've shared many of these ways with my one-on-one coaching client. A lot of them, they don't have a 1,000 subscriber channel, but then they can still make money with their channels. And so also in terms of cash flow, I just want to say you should really focus on no cap cash flows, no cap. So cash flow really, in my opinion, there are two main forms. One is no cap, one is with cap. And if you're a salaried employee, of course, your salary has a cap because there is a max of how much you can make unless you're in sales and you can make commissions, and that's a different story. But for most professions, most white collar professionals, there is definitely a cap to their earnings. And then there's also no cap. And no cap just means you're rewarded by your performance. You can earn commissions, you can earn bonuses. And that in my opinion, is no cap. And so when you're trying to find side hustles, of course, you can also trade your time for money. And that is definitely capped because your time is capped. And I currently still do a lot of things that are capped, such as my one-on-one coaching. That is definitely capped because I have a limited amount of time. I can't take on like 1,000 clients at the same time. That is just not possible. And each of my sessions are 1 hour long. So I can't possibly take on like more than 8 clients at the same time. And so that is definitely capped. And the reason why I do one-on-one coaching is more for personal fulfillment and seeing people's transformation. And I want to be part of that transformation. I want people to, like, selfishly, I want people to remember me when they become big one day. They'd be like, oh, I remember Cherry was like one of the contributors to the tipping point of my life. Like, I want to do that for people. And so one-on-one coaching is more for personal fulfillment, not really for just money making. If you want to just be money making, just sell a $2,000 course. Like, no one's stopping you. That is going to make you money. Of course, you have to have the right channels. You have to have the right traffic, but that's off topic. In terms of no cap, for example, YouTube is very no cap. You don't necessarily have to put in more hours for more people to watch you. It's really irrelevant. You really just need to know how to do SEO properly. You have to know how to do your title, your description, your tags. You have to know how to make more interesting and enticing videos, how to give value to people. And so that is like the whole art of YouTube, but it really has no cap. Your YouTube income is not directly related to how much time you spend on YouTube. And also other no cap, affiliate marketing also has no cap. So you don't necessarily have to put in X amount of hours in order to get Y amount of money. So that is also no cap. So when you're doing your side hustle research, it is also helpful to have some no cap income source. Of course, like, some people come up to me and they're like, Cherry, currently I make $0 and I just want to make all passive income. And I think that is just highly irresponsible. And let me just stop my screen share. I think that is highly irresponsible. And overall, I think that is just kind of unrealistic, because I really believe you have to make actual income before you make passive income. So if you can't even make active income, if you can't even trade your time for money, then how can you make passive income? That just doesn't make sense. And so I only help people who are currently making active income, and they show the discipline, they show the work ethics to make those active income, then I'll help them make passive income. If someone doesn't even have the discipline or the ability to make active income, passive income is even more difficult. So I don't know how much I can help people who are just downright lazy and doesn't want to put in the work and doesn't want to invest in themselves and doesn't want to invest in their knowledge and their business. I just don't want to help any freeloaders. And so this video is probably quite long. I'll have to have a fun time editing it, but please let me know how you like this new format. And before I run out of my voice even more, also download the guide in the info box. You can find a lot of valuable information in this free 10-page guide, and I really hope that it can help you.